earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena.
Debatably, I have a dream.
Shouldn't we consider in every nation a fundamental restructuring of economic, political, social, and religious institutions?
We have come here to let you know that change is coming, whether you like it or not.
Undo reality and remake it in a way that allows for a more hopeful present.
Hi everyone, welcome to Cosmic. Human beings on planet Earth trying to figure out what the hell is going on here. It feels like some drugs are heavily criminalized and some others are widely encouraged through capitalistic market dynamics and enabling policies. Take sugar, for instance, alcohol, coffee, they're everywhere. Well, sugar is not a drug, or is it? I don't know anymore. Okay, let's back up for a second. I invited someone who is going to guide us through this discussion. His name is Ethan Nadelmann, and he's the founder of the Drug Policy Alliance in New York, working to end the war on drugs. Described by Rolling Stone as the driving force for the legalization of marijuana in America. Welcome to the show.
Camille, it's good to be on this show with you.
I have a lot of questions for you. What did you hear? What did you think when you heard Rolling Stone say that you're the driving force for the legalization of marijuana in America? What came to mind?
Well, put it this way. I mean, many people have been involved in the effort, and I'm proud of the role I've played. So in that sense, it was very nice. In another sense, I feel sometimes that our success on the marijuana legalization effort has overshadowed all the other work we've done to try to roll back the war on drugs.
Right.
Because in my time, you know, in the 30 years I spent working on this, ending the war on marijuana, legalizing marijuana, first for medical purposes and then more broadly for adults, and even reducing the arrests and all of that, it was only a third of our work. I mean, we're also focused on rolling back mass incarceration in America and these horrifically long penalties for possessing and using and buying and selling cocaine and heroin. We were deeply involved in advancing harm reduction approaches to reduce the spread of HIV/AIDS, to reduce the overdose fatality issue, to educate young people about drugs in a more effective and responsible way than the norm. So it's the Rolling Stone thing feels good, and I've had a nice relationship with Rolling Stone magazine for many, many years, but it both overstates and understates what I feel I did.
Would you prefer to have an actual relationship with the Rolling Stones, the band?
You know, I have to tell you, one of my weaknesses as an advocate was I was never that good at hanging out with celebrities.
Okay.
I think we might have been a little more successful if I'd been better at that.
All right. Well, obviously, you're known as a high-profile critic and commentator on U.S. and international drug control policies. That's something I wanted to talk about today, talking about, well, drug policy in general. Also diving into legalization of marijuana, which is still very controversial in so many areas of the world, and trying to understand from a sort of nerdy change maker perspective how change is moving in that space. We're going to talk about narratives, and maybe some other topics will come up as we unfold the discussion.
Yeah, no, I'll tell you, it's an interesting time in my own life to be doing this interview with you because, you know, I spent virtually my entire adult life focused on trying to transform public opinion and public law around drugs, psychoactive drugs, the illicit ones. Right. And then I basically stopped 2 years ago. I stepped down from running my organization, and I've been in a period of sort of reflection and enjoyment and, you know, engaging here and there. But it's a time when I'm thinking of writing my own book and doing this and really reflecting about, you know, what role I played and how I made change happen and whether or not there are actually broader lessons from my relatively unique experience. So
well,
happy to talk about it with you.
Well, great. Hopefully we can shed some light on some kind of book structure or something.
That would be nice.
tough transition from an upbeat style of music, but can you tell me how you explain the war on drugs and sort of laying out that narrative and the key points that you must be making all the time? It's a good introduction.
There's both the U.S. element of this thing, which has been a dominant one over the last century, because the U.S. government really made the advancing, the promoting, the proselytizing of the drug war a key part of our identity globally, right? We made it a commitment. You know, we, from the early days of the 20th century, played a pivotal role in the international conventions that prohibited drugs. We used our power both bilaterally and multilaterally to encourage and cajole and to almost force other countries to buy into our approach. There was a sense in the U.S. proselytizing around this war on drugs that was almost wanting other countries to adopt and embrace our approach as almost a way of legitimizing ourselves by forcing others to mirror what we do, thereby legitimizing it. Now, if you ask why we did in America what we did, the first and most important thing to remember is that we were one of the only countries in the Western world that criminalized alcohol. Right? I mean, we had a period in the mid-19th century where there was support for prohibition. It faded it. And then the late 19th, early 20th century, a huge, huge popular movement to criminalize alcohol. Mm. Where a temperance movement to try to reduce the problems of alcohol turned into a prohibitionist movement. And it got tied in with some very good progressive movements in the fight for women's suffrage, the right to vote, and all these sorts of things. But we had that sentiment, this notion that almost a religious sentiment that our body are God's precious vessels on earth, and that we have an obligation to our Lord, our Maker, to keep these vessels pure of these substances. We believed in putting our morals into the criminal laws, not just when it came to murder, rape, and other immoral acts right. that hurt other people, but basically to something that was essentially self-regarding, an activity, consuming a substance that in the vast majority of cases has no impact on other human beings. So this notion that because alcohol was evil, and if only we could prohibit it, we would make it disappear, and then fathers would stop beating their children and beating their wives, and we would reduce accidents on the roads and in the factories and all this. It was a powerful movement.
What year was it?
It began in the late 19th century. It built up, and then basically around the end of the First World War,
right.
after many states had already criminalized alcohol, we embraced the 18th Amendment. Very hard to change the U.S. Constitution. We've only done it a few dozen times in our history, but we changed the U.S. Constitution to prohibit alcohol, right? And for about 14 years, from 1919 until 1933, alcohol was prohibited at the state and federal level. And we all know the history. Well, to some extent. Because, in fact, at the very beginning of alcohol prohibition, it looked like it was working. Right? Mm. I mean, at the very beginning, already alcohol use had been going down, World War I, anti-German sentiment leading to boycotts on breweries, people having a spirit of self-sacrifice for the war, all of these other good things. And it kept going down. But after a few years, alcohol use bottomed out and it started to rise. And at the same time, you had the emergence of Al Capone and organized and unorganized criminals and millions of Americans making bathtub gin and having the backyard still and, close to half the population effectively violating the alcohol laws, governors, mayors, even presidents serving alcohol in these places discreetly. The whole speakeasy culture emerges then. The cocktail culture emerges then. Women start drinking with men. It was really a part of a broader cultural transformation. And in the early 30s, I mean, basically, prohibition, the sport for it, comes crashing down, in part because of the economic depression, in part because taxing alcohol had been a major source of tax revenue, and all of a sudden we need to, get revenue again. One reason America adopted the income tax was because the government was no longer getting money from the alcohol tax,
right?
So it had a big impact, and when we prohibit alcohol, already there was a prejudice against these other drugs, against opium, and which was associated with the Chinese, migrants, and minorities, against cocaine, which had been associated with black people, against cannabis, marijuana, which was associated with Mexican Americans and Mexican migrants to the U.S., and also with other deviant sorts of populations throughout the rest of the country.
Stigmas.
So that passion, the passion around alcohol Once we gave that up, it was almost as if we could add all that extra passion into the criminalization of these other psychoactive substances, which were not so popular in society, which had a much greater association with demonized minorities, and there was very little standing in its way.
Mm. Oh, wow. Well, that's a great way to set the stage. And then from there, there was the movement in the 60s with all the this cultural revolution.
And well, the 60s and 70s was, the 60s really with Nixon was really two things going on. On the one hand, you had, what was Nixon going to do about middle America and about suburban and the blacks and blacks beginning to act up and Martin Luther King and then Black Power, Malcolm X, and then beginning violence in the streets? And how was Nixon as a Republican going to play off of that, right, in terms of the public? And in a way, going after drugs became an effective way of saying, I'm helping the black community. But in fact, I'm playing to that racist sentiment that has always lurked within American psyche.
Yeah.
So one part of it was that, right? It was about Americans are freaked out about crime. They're freaked out about black people, white Americans about black people. We can't use the language of the racists in the South, the George Wallaces and all the racist language. But if we say junkies and drug traffickers and pushers and dealers, you know the imagery that's going to pop up in the American mind is typically not of a white person, but of a dark-skinned person.
Of course.
The other part of this was all of this college opposition, you know, the hippies and the academics and the universities and intellectuals who were all aghast at Nixon's behavior, at the growing involvement in the Vietnam War, all of these other sorts of things, and where the drug culture was increasingly accepted. And so for him, identifying all those anti-war protesters with drugs and the hippies with drugs and the Jewish intellectuals with drugs and all the others, it became this kind of 1-2 punch for him to go after the college campus, you know, protesters and the intellectuals on the one hand with the connection with marijuana and psychedelics, and Timothy Leary was part of that, and on the other hand about crime and the American fear of crime and black people and all that. And those two dovetailed to create what was in some respects not the first drug war in America, but it was really the language of the drug war really emerged, where right. Nixon around 1970-71 declares drugs public enemy number one,
right,
and says we need a war on drugs to, you know, save our country.
Yeah, that was a moment. And so you shake those narratives for a few decades, and looking at what's going on today, just staying on what the war on drugs looks like. What are some of the impacts in the U.S.
Look, I mean, in fact, there was a period when Nixon leaves and when Jimmy Carter is president in the late 70s, when there's this brief period of liberalization, when many Americans think that the legalization of marijuana is inevitable. Mm. When 11 states decriminalize marijuana and Jimmy Carter, in the late 70s, his attorney general, introduces a federal bill to not legalize, but to decriminalize marijuana. So, and even where dealing with drugs as a health issue began to gain currency. But that only lasted a few years. And then the movement in the late 70s opening up towards the Ronald Reagan, the Reagan Revolution, and the shift now from the generation of the 80s, including young people, turning their back on the kind of radicalism of the 60s and the live and let live ism of the 70s, and parents being freaked out about the growing use of marijuana, and Ronald Reagan wanting to play that crime card and the subtle use of the race card as well. So the modern war on drugs really begins within the first few years of Ronald Reagan's administration and begins to heat up in the late 80s with crack cocaine and then the international drug war and the targeting of countries, Latin America, you know, Colombia and Bolivia and Peru and Mexico with all the drug, and that's when the modern day drug war happens. Mm-hmm. And in many respects, in its impact, if not its rhetoric, it dwarfs the Nixonian drug war. Mm-hmm. This is when, I mean, the number one impact in the United States, until roughly 1970, the incarceration rate in the United States was roughly similar to other countries in the Western world.
Right.
But that begins to take off in the 70s, and the 80s it moves like a rocket.
Right.
So that by the time you hit the early 2000s, the United States, with less than 5% of the world's population, has 25% of the world's incarcerated population. We have the highest incarceration rate in the world, even today. The Russians in second place keep huffing and puffing to keep up with us. We've left them in the dust. We are number one when it comes to locking up our full of citizens. No democratic society in history has ever locked up this proportion, this higher proportion of its fellow citizens, right? And when it comes to locking up black people, it made apartheid South Africa or the Soviet gulags look like almost child's play in terms of the percentage of people being locked up. What drove that overwhelmingly in the 80s, 90s, and early part of the new century was the war on drugs. It was accounting for 30, 40, even 50% of men being sent to some state prisons, even more with women, right? So just crazy numbers. This period, I oftentimes refer to it, it's like McCarthyism on steroids.
Right.
Right? All the fears and paranoias of McCarthyism in the 50s and the anti-communist hysteria, but on steroids, literally on drugs and locking up people in the way that McCarthyism had never done.
To fight this, we're going to listen to a love song. So you, during this period, you grow up with, you know, probably as an observer first. What's going on?
You know, I'm born in New York in 1957. I grew up in a suburb. My dad's a kind of modern day rabbi. I grew up in a fairly moral family, Sabbath observant. I go off to college in the mid 70s at McGill University. I smoke cannabis. Actually, hashish was more common than marijuana up in Montreal in those days. And you know, it just kind of hits me: why are people getting busted for this stuff? Because friends were getting busted at the border. And you know, I smoke marijuana, but I do very well in school. I get into Harvard. I get degrees.
Right.
And, I try the psychedelics. I try some of the other substances. And, you know, I know people have a problem with it, but most people I know, including me, don't have a problem. In fact, these substances are kind of a net plus in my own personal life. I get interested in U.S. foreign policy, Middle East politics. I'm kind of moving towards an academic career. And then I burn out on that whole Middle East thing. I just think it's hopeless. And friends point out to me that I seem to be always interested in the deviant side of things and in drugs. And so in part because I wasn't taking my own, you know, career very seriously, I said, hell, you know, why don't I write a PhD dissertation on the international drug issue? And so that's what I decided to do.
Wow.
Yeah. And actually, I begin really by researching the other side. One of my professors encourages me to focus not on writing a history of U.S. anti-drug diplomacy, but instead of looking at how police and prosecutors deal with crime when it becomes internationalized.
Right.
And so I managed to talk my way into the State Department. I get myself a security clearance. I work in the State Department's Narcotics Bureau in the mid-80s. I write a classified report on dealing with drug-related money laundering. I get letters of introduction from the DEA and from Interpol. I then travel to 19 countries all around Latin America and Europe, you know, interviewing U.S. and foreign drug enforcement agents.
Wow.
And customs officers and CIA and prosecutors and diplomats, but all throughout Latin America and Europe. And I eventually write a dissertation and a book called Cops Across Borders, which is about how police and prosecutors and diplomats deal with crime when it becomes international. nationalized. And because these guys had opened up their door to me and been very open with me, I lean over backwards not to be critical of their overall enterprise.
Right.
Really to explain, how do they do what they do?
Right.
But meanwhile, objectively, but meanwhile, the I'm doing the reading on how these drug laws came about in the first place and the role that racism and xenophobia played in the emergence of these drug laws, not just in the United States, but even in other countries. I'm becoming more appreciative of how the laws are absurd, not just with respect to cannabis, but even with respect to other drugs that I had always thought were incredibly dangerous, and beginning to realize that even though these other drugs like cocaine and heroin are relatively more dangerous than cannabis, it doesn't justify their being criminalized than they've been, right? So another part of me is saying this whole thing's crazy, and in 1987, is that, 32 years ago, I get a job teaching at Princeton University, very prestigious university in the U.S., and they ask me to teach a class on drug policy.
Ooh.
And meanwhile, I'm beginning to write stuff about this, and then I write, and meanwhile, the drug war, which had been kind of a backwater issue when I first got interested in 1980, you know, 2, 3, 4 in this issue, the drug wars are now the number one thing in the late 80s in the U.S. media, major magazines, TV shows. You can't turn on the TV without seeing some TV show like with the reporters jumping in the back of a police car to go bust people and knock down doors and all the, and there's an international thing and they're closing the border with Mexico and they're, I mean, all of this stuff. And I write this article in the spring of 88 in a prestigious magazine called Foreign Policy, basically saying this whole war on drugs is ridiculous. It's a terrible thing. The hell is called a bad export because we're exporting it to foreign countries. And I'm saying, you know, drugs are certainly a problem. Drug use is a problem. But the war on drugs and these prohibitionist policies are doing far more harm than good and more harm even than drugs itself.
You came out of the woods.
So I came out of the, yeah, exactly. And a few weeks later, a very brave new mayor of Baltimore, Kurt Schmo, comes out and says the same thing. And a few weeks later, The Economist magazine in the UK for the first time comes out and says the same thing, all without having read my stuff.
Right.
And the next thing I know, I'm a 31-year-old young assistant professor at Princeton, and I'm on all the major U.S. national media with, you know, debating senators and politicians and anti-drug activists and flying around the world. And this just starts to build up. So here I am at Princeton teaching my courses, trying to finish turning my dissertation a book about the law enforcement side and not making my views in there. And meanwhile, writing and speaking and becoming the leading speaker around the U.S. and the world about what's wrong with the war on drugs. And everybody says, well, you're just a total legalizer. But in fact, I'm not. I'm not a libertarian who thinks that all drugs should be sold over the counter legally. I'm somebody who's a human rights oriented person,
right,
who thinks that nobody should be punished for what they put into their body as long as they don't hurt anybody else, and who thinks we're better off trying to figure out ways to regulate these substances, and that if we need to keep some parts of it illegal, keep the cops and criminal laws at the edges of this thing, not front and center. And so I get active as an intellectual and as a speaker, and then other people are beginning to start some advocacy organizations, so I become deeply involved with them. And I create a working group at Princeton to try to envision what would be the ideal drug control policy and get a lot of the leading scholars and thinkers about that. And then in 1992, I'd been teaching at Princeton for 5 years, I get a call out of the blue from a fellow named George Soros. Who was a financier and a philanthropist, not that well known. I go to meet him, and I said, what do you want to meet about? And he says, well, you know, I've been deeply involved in trying to bring down communism and socialist dictatorship in the former Soviet Union, Eastern Europe. And lo and behold, it all collapsed faster than I ever expected. And I'm a believer in open society and open society values.
Right.
And I've been asking myself, what about America is not reflective of open society values? And the drug war seems to be exhibit A. And I say, well, you're damn right about that. We spent 2 hours talking, arguing, all this. And finally, he looks at me and he says, well, look, I see we basically agree on the key issues. I have a lot to learn still, he says. But we agree on the basics here, right? We'll have our differences. Now, I'm a very busy man, but I have substantial resources, he says. So let's assume I want to empower you to accomplish our common objectives. So I laughed, I went home, I sent him a proposal, he got cold feet, then 2 months later he broke the British bank and made a couple billion dollars, and all of a sudden he's a famous financier and philanthropist.
92, right?
92, yeah. And then in 93 we shook hands on a deal, and then in 94 I left Princeton and started up my institute, first as the first major project of his U.S. part of his foundation, and then just built it up from there, first within his foundation, then spinning it out into an independent organization. organization and building Drug Policy Alliance into what became the biggest and largest and leading drug policy reform organization in the world.
Man, what a story.
It was fun.
Down the right, guess all my cares to waste. I won't waste time. Won't waste time. Make a war horse from a war saw. This a war call for the future to come. And bring it back like. It's young David, I'm war ready to sword. Heavy, I forced every opponent to change course. And I'm more steady poor. Every ounce of my spirit in it, uncensored, unfiltered, off kilter, like I'm off a six packer. Liquid courage, I know that your core's scary. I've been in the crunch time, explored every option, employed every resource, adopted a doctrine that's true to my conquest. Cognizant of the platform that I've garnered. Garnish my words like a farmer, manuring his crops for the harvest. My yield is a target. You sow, you reap. The more you keep, the less you gain. Before I meet the reaper, pray the words I speak become coveted. It's a covenant for change. Sort of like what MLK wanted, in ways they can't stomach. I pay homage to leaders before me. Still I rise, eh? Cool down the right. Guess all my cares to waste. I won't waste time. Make a war horse from a war saw. This a war call for the future to come. And bring it back like.
Let's get it started for the deli departing. No audit for niggas that's making money out of the oven. Cousin, I love and a mule of the president on the face. Man, a lawyer, I'm Mason, and he beat the case. Ain't no love for the rats, but the ace with the bass. My joker's a wild card, it we be days. There be more pizza, more dip, I'll incur y'all. In other words, I was raised with that crayon. Like New Orleans voodoo, shitty, this is crayon. Let me see your palm, nigga, cause I can read all. They ate off in his hand and he's going for kill. I'm protected by what I can't see but can feel. And I'm holding my breath underwater like seal. Then we come from the fields. Bad bunny unconscious. This is what happened when we set off the record launchers. When Melly Mel was saying Shaka Khan, let me rock this. I was in the projects doing the gymnastics on the pissy mattress. Yeah, the big red man Eddie came. With five heartbeats in the rain. I just like this. I wish that. Cause I never got caught with a brick. Yeah, hit them with the llama, but they missed. Yeah, drive by, they looking like kids. But y'all looking like Godzilla fit. Check the feature, son of a preacher. Last supper boy, I be sick with Peter. Mary Magdalene told me there's an informer. You won't see the sign when he kissed by Judah. Romans gonna pull up with the horse and shooters. Peter gonna pull us all and cut the soldier.
Just till I rise, eh? Down the right. Guess all my kids to waste. I won't waste time.
Won't waste time.
Make a war horse from a war saw. This a war call for the future to come. And bring it back like ooh.
So what I'd like to talk about, following up on, I mean, there's so much to unpack in what you said, and in that, you know, what typically happens when markets evolve. I would like to talk about what happens when a drug gets legalized, and maybe we can take the example of marijuana, in terms of, you know, so there's a crime rate, like between quotes, there's a lucrative business going on that's profiting someone. If there is this narrative that is, you know, loaded with guilt and stigmatization, and then suddenly everyone gets interested, right? Everyone's sort of placing its business interests even before. I mean, we see this now in France, for instance, where the debate is getting hot, and now like who's going to get the market? And suddenly narrative changes. Like, can you talk a little bit about that transition and the before and the after?
Well, you know, I mean, sometimes people used to say we have to legalize this stuff to take the money out of it. No, I mean, the money is in it. And I have to say, even when it comes to capitalism, I mean, there's all types of capitalism, right? The thing that makes me sick is crony capitalism. It's the pretense that we're going to believe in free markets, but in fact, as soon as people get economic power, they try to turn it into political power and try to corrupt free market capitalism in order to benefit their own interests. So crony capitalism is the ugly part of what's going on. The commercialism, the desire to make money, that's always been part of this, whether it's illegal or legal. And the question is, if people are going to be making money buying and selling this sort of stuff, or growing and selling this stuff, is it going to be legally regulated, or is it going to be illegal? Are we going to keep it in the big stuff in the hands of gangsters who resort to violence to resolve disputes and take over territory, as well as, you know, much less problematic low-level folks who are just trying to make a living growing this weed illegally in the back hills or whatever, or selling a little, you know, to friends in the neighborhood? Or are we going to create a legal, regulated environment where the companies that emerge are going to try to acquire greater and greater legitimate economic power and turn it into some levels of political power?
Right.
So neither situation is perfect, right? One can look, you know, my view was that the number one priority is a that nobody should be hurt or punished in the case. Well, I think this is true with all drugs, not marijuana, that nobody deserves to be punished or lose their freedom simply for the possession or use of any psychoactive substance, so long as they're not getting behind the wheel of a car or putting other people at risk or hurting them, right? Heroin, cocaine, methamphetamine, LSD, mushrooms, marijuana, you name it. Hey, if that's in your pocket and you're going to take it when you're home or not going to bother anybody, that should not be a crime, right? It's to some extent what Portugal's done, some other European countries have done now, and what we're advocating for in the U.S., not just with marijuana. Then the question becomes, well, who's going to produce and sell this stuff and distribute it?
Right.
And then, is it going to be regulated or not? Well, so my view was, look, inevitably, especially in America, which is probably still the most dynamic capitalist society on earth and in history, it's eventually going to be taken over by people who are very good at exercising economic power. It's going to be taken over by disproportionately white men, or but not by black people, et cetera, you know, but basically white men who know how to deal with government regulators, who know how to raise capital, who know how to play in the stock markets, all this sort of stuff. And eventually, when the thing gets legalized at the level of the federal government nationally, that's when you'll see big alcohol, tobacco, pharmaceutical companies and consumer good companies coming in. And in fact, you already see them coming in and buying parts of Canadian companies.
Right.
Do I like that? No. Would I prefer to see, you know, did I fight to legalize marijuana in order to see the Marlboroization or Budweiserization of marijuana? No, I did not. Would I prefer a kind of small is beautiful model, a kind of, you know, microbrewery model or a vineyard model? Yes, of course.
Well, that just switches to another area of, you know, of the debate, which is true with any kind of commodity or resource, right? It's how do we sell and how do we produce and how, you know, what's the economic model of our societies? I mean, that's true with also with coffee, with, you know, anything. So
well, exactly.
It reaches that point where it,
well, Camille, if you think about it, like Uruguay, after we legalized marijuana in Colorado and Washington in 2012, then Uruguay became the first country to legalize in 2013. And we brought some of the Uruguayans up to America to look what was happening with medical marijuana in California, what Colorado and Washington were talking about. And they said, we don't want to do that. You know, but Uruguay has a much more government, the public is much more supportive of a very highly interventionist role of government economy,
right,
in a way that France might tolerate, for example, or maybe Switzerland might tolerate, right? You know, in America, that's just not tolerated in that way. So for us, capitalism is highly dynamic, both for better and for worse.
Right.
Now, at the same time, there was a demand for high levels of regulation of marijuana in these markets for public health purposes, to protect kids, for environmental purposes, energy conservation purposes. If you put high levels of regulation, that means that the traditional marijuana growers who are growing illegally, they don't have the resources and expertise to deal with government regulators.
No.
So, you know, you can train some of them to make the transition, but many of them aren't really cut out to make that kind of transition. Then you look at the efficiencies. Why is marijuana growing in the Humboldt, the Emerald Triangle, Humboldt and Mendocino in Northern California? Well, there's certain things about the climate that make it appealing. But what really makes it appealing is that, you know, it's a dense area. It's mountainous in a way. You know, it's hard for law enforcement to get in there. Once you no longer need to hide your marijuana, either from the government or from criminals trying to raid it, right, you can grow it in the Central Valley where they grow everything,
right,
essentially.
So maybe in practice, through maybe some of the cases that you have in the U.S. with, you know, what happened in California, Colorado, Ohio is trying to, where are we with this? Like, because there was this intent to monopolize and to put a few players.
Ohio was a weird one. I mean, basically, if you think about the history of this U.S., right, we started with medical marijuana back in 96. You know, I was deeply involved in organizing. I mean, somebody else wrote the initiative, some local activists, but I put together the funding and the campaign that made that the first major victory for marijuana reform and even drug policy reform in the United States in 96. And, you know, we didn't even set up the whole dispensary system. That really emerged with the New Mexico law around 2007. So it was an evolving process of slowly, you know, of sort of trial by error and of kind of changing the law and then seeing how governments reacted and seeing how entrepreneurs dealt with this thing. And in the early years, it was always a criminal element, but there was also a highly idealistic element about providing this medicine for people. You know, and then when legalization began to become viable, another organization was involved in some early legalization initiatives, which were premature and we stayed out. But with Colorado and Washington in 2012, it was like, let's write this law. And we were involved in writing these laws. And then in Oregon, Alaska, 2014, and other states, including California, 2016. And do the best we can. And let's talk to all the stakeholders. Let's try to find a way, we said in California, so that the smaller players can stay involved.
Right.
Let's have lower license fees for them. Mm. Let's restrict to the extent to which the big companies can become vertically integrated. So they have to make a choice. Do they want to be in distribution or production? Right? So you don't have dominant players, right?
Right.
You know, there's some advantage. The fact that marijuana is still, even as states are legalizing it, that it's not legal at the federal, national level. What that means is that the big alcohol, tobacco, pharmaceutical companies don't feel comfortable getting in as yet. And even on Wall Street, they're going kind of slowly. So it's kept the biggest players from jumping in, say, the way it's happened in Canada, where now Canada is nationally legal, and there's nothing blocking the biggest companies from getting involved in this stuff. But what I say is, what we've tried to do, in part because I and my organization, Drug Policy Alliance, really stood for social justice values, is we wrote into these initiatives, especially California, that if you're going to legalize marijuana, a percentage of the tax revenues has to go to benefit those communities, especially black and brown communities, that were most harmed by the drug war. That if we're going to do this, we have to give those farmers living off the grid and six a chance to participate, right? That let's try to do this the right way.
Right.
Now, a few years from now, I mean, more and more industry is going to drive this in the future. And they're just going to give lip service to this unless activists are standing up, including racial justice advocates, saying, wait a second, we need to get a piece of this too. New York and New Jersey came close to legalizing marijuana this year, and it may still happen this year or next. One of the big arguments was how much is the new law going to include provisions to help those people who got most screwed over by the war on drugs.
Yeah, and of course, I mean, that's actually I wanted to ask you about that, because in France, for instance, where, you know, basically we've been parking immigrants for years in the suburbs, right? Mm-hmm. And governments never been active in, you know, creating integration and taking care of that responsibility and creating the platform for those communities to, you know, to thrive. The $1 billion or euros that are, you know, today cannabis in France are run by those neighborhoods, right? The minute it gets legal, I mean, and that's why, well, France in particular has been sort of waiting and sort of taking the temperature and is still not moving, because the day you make this legal, what they say is that, you know, the cigarette distributors are going to take over, and you got riots. Like,
yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'd say, I mean, because I've followed many countries, and I was just in France, Paris, a few years ago, testifying. There was a senator, I think Esther Bombas, her name is, who did a hearing in the Senate on legalization of cannabis. So I was invited to testify, and that stuff's online and such. And I think France has always had a weird conservatism around the drug issue, more so not just in the Netherlands and Switzerland and Denmark, but even more so than Germany and other countries and Spain. And it's just, France has been weird on that stuff. You
of
know?
Course, it's very sensitive.
It's a sensitivity, and there's a conservatism to it. And then meanwhile, of course, there is a race and ethnic dimension.
Absolutely.
Even though you prohibit the collecting of statistics on, well, a friend of mine, Fabrice Olivet, is a Frenchman who's been focused on harm reduction, but also looking at trying to bring attention to the racist elements of French criminal justice and drug policy. So I think with France, look, there's a historical analogy here. For decades, the numbers was the underground gambling thing where people would bet like on a lottery each week, was a major source of revenue and power oftentimes in African-American communities. And there was some violence associated with it and some corruption associated with it, but it brought a lot of revenue in. And once the government shifted to legalize, you know, government-run lotteries and legalize gambling, well, it really undercut a kind of illicit market that was fairly vibrant and probably doing more good than bad. And in fact, some people will trace the origins of the deep involvement in the drug trade of key elements of, you know, black, you know, poor communities to the elimination or reduction of the numbers trade. Mm. So there's always this issue of that if you're basically going to destroy a dynamic illicit economy in an impoverished area, there's a question, it's going to help some elements of the neighborhood because these illicit trades do involve violence and corruption.
Absolutely.
And empowering of people and young people looking at drug dealers as role models and cops, you know, searching people for possession of drugs.
And, yeah.
So there's a lot of bad sides to the prohibition of cannabis in these markets, but there's the good side in terms of bringing in a lot of revenue, and to the extent the trade is not violent, you know, the argument is sometimes said, I used to wonder, in fact, would we be better off if we just had the Dutch system, right, where they haven't formally legalized it, but where all possession's essentially legal and where you have government quasi-regulated coffee shops and it was not big business, or in Denmark, in Copenhagen, they used to have the little area of Christiania, which had a sort of open cannabis trade. And in some ways, the early years of the Netherlands cannabis policy, or Christiania, were the best of all worlds, because you didn't have sort of crony capitalism coming or the big guys. You had a lot of small entrepreneurs making money. You didn't have the gangsters involved. The problem is, it's not a stable setting. So eventually, what happens in the Netherlands? You start getting people with these mega grows, and then you start having gangsters begin to strong arm the growers, and then people start landing up dead in the industry.
Yeah, yeah.
Or in Christiania, where the biker gangs take over the distribution and they're killing people.
Right.
So in a way, even though legalization means in most places, maybe not France, as it did not in Uruguay so far, but even though legalization means that you're going to have legitimate, you know, legally taxed and licensed big players coming in and serving their own interests, I sometimes see that as the least bad way of dealing with the realities of the marijuana market.
Yeah.
Now, I should also say, when we legalized in California, we also made sure that the penalties for people who continued to grow illegally, even when marijuana was legal, were not that tough. Right?
Right.
Because what happens is you legalize marijuana and all of a sudden the people making money legally from it want the cops to crack down on the people who are still growing marijuana illegally.
Right.
And we didn't want that to happen in a big way either.
But I think it's a symptom that, you know, because I'm not suggesting that we should keep the status quo or anything like this. It's terrible, like getting those kids involved and all the, you know, the gangsters, as you say. It's terrible. It's very, very sad. But it's yet another symptom on that transition discussion, on everything, on the way we manage resources, on the economy, the model of our economy. Is like it's a file that when you open that file, you can't hide, and you have to ask yourself the tough questions of, you know, what is the model, the development model for those neighborhoods?
That's right.
For real now.
Well, that's why it helps.
Let's talk about it.
If one can write into the legislation that a large share of the tax revenue will specifically go to those communities that were both harmed and helped by the preceding criminalization, it's one way to help address that. If part of the revenue goes for specific things like enabling people to get trained so they can participate in these markets, giving people the skills so they can be effective legal entrepreneurs, not just illegal entrepreneurs, those are ways of trying to make the best of the transition.
You're listening to Cosmic on Spotify, on your favorite podcast app, watching on YouTube. We're here talking about tough topics. We'll be back after the song.
We cannot not seem to give till it all comes crashing down again, down again. The tide of our love will not set us free. The tide of our love brings you back to me. The tide of our love will not set us free. The tide of our love brings you back to me. Your love, it is blinding. My love, it's in hiding. We sit in between two worlds. You
shout out to ICEARS, who's making this interview possible through the AYA conference where we're sitting today. We talked about this conference in Cosmic 27. There's a lot of interesting insights from Benjamin there. I guess, you know, we got quite deep quite quickly, and because it's I wanted to maybe take the time to talk about narratives for some of the listeners that maybe are tuning in from countries like in the Nordics, and where, you know, it's really not okay culturally to, you know, pull out a joint in a party. It's alcohol, like getting wasted every Friday and Saturday, and, you know, kids, yeah, like you have this big taboo discussion. Or situation, even on alcohol, right? Like I, when I was living in Sweden, I remember I was invited for dinners, and the 16, 17 year old would never ever drink a glass of wine at that dinner in front of his parents, right? Where in my culture, in France, like, you know, we start to love wine and start to understand it and try it since age, you know, eight, yeah, nine. Well, it depends on the regions, but it's never...
Well, it's what they say, you know, you look at alcohol consumption in Scandinavia and all the northern parts of the world in a way, and you basically drink to get drunk.
Exactly,
you know? And
that's
to some
the
extent,
thing.
I sometimes think that any place in the world where either the sun shines 20 hours a day or it's dark 20 hours a day, those places tend to have bigger problems with alcohol.
Yeah.
And what you saw in Scandinavia is that they were so traumatized by their experience with alcohol. They were among the few other countries that went towards an alcohol prohibition model when, yeah, the U.S. went to alcohol prohibition. And in a way, they've tried to figure out how to regulate their alcohol experience, but they've extended that kind of phobias around the other drugs. And it's to some extent the opposite of what you see in Southern Europe, where, you know, Italy, mange, eat, drink, you know, this, right, sort of stuff, or France. Now, what's happened in Scandinavia is interesting because for a long time, Sweden was like Singapore in Europe when it, right, came to drugs. People are always shocked because Sweden's so liberal on so many things, but on the drugs, they were like a Singapore mindset, highly punitive, coercive. They don't put people in prison the way we do in the U.S., but really, yeah, really repressive.
On the other hand, crazy on alcohol, like really, well, like getting hammered.
No, exactly. Like, that whole, right, yeah, you drink to get drunk, you don't drink the way people do elsewhere.
Right.
Now, what's happened happened, fortunately, is that the Swedish influence on the rest of Scandinavia has been steadily diminishing, and the Swedish power over EU drug policy has been diminishing as well. So first the Danes really break off, you know? I mean, they do it. They always had a somewhat liberal thing on cannabis, that Christiana thing. But then on other things, they move forward on harm reduction. They embrace more of the Dutch and German and Spanish approach. They open up not just needle exchange, but they open up safe injection sites. They begin prescribing pharmaceutical heroin to serious heroin addicts. You know, they have active drug user areas. I mean, so Denmark breaks off. And then Norway's in a really interesting situation because they're the kind of like looked down on little brother of Sweden in a way, the one, you know. And you have a remarkable figure, Thorvald Stoltenberg, former foreign minister, leading diplomat. His son is now the head of NATO and the former head of the former prime minister, of who had three children. One, the son I just mentioned. Another one, a daughter who became a heroin addict and got through it. And a third who has like the public health, you know, administration in Norway. And Thorvald Stoltenberg, we became friends. He joins the Global Commission on Drug Policy, but even before that, becomes an effective force for a much more progressive drug policy in Norway. Mm. And meanwhile, you have some wonderful local activists beginning to mobilize as well. So Norway is now beginning to open a safe injection site. Norway is doing harm reduction. Norway is going to start a heroin prescribing program, right? Iceland has a kind of Swedish-like policy, and you have a very repressive police force that is going into, you know, clubs where young people dance with dogs and stuff like that. But there's beginning to be a popular movement against that as well. And even in Sweden, things are beginning to get less intense.
Right.
So I think what's happening is that with marijuana, though, that's the one where Scandinavia, even in Norway, they had. It's weird.
It.
They're pretty far along on harm reduction with the hard drugs,
yeah.
But they're kind of stuck on the cannabis thing. And so lots of Scandinavians, you know, they go down to Netherlands or Germany, whatever, and get their stuff. It's a weird cultural thing,
yeah.
You know. I mean,
and it's so stigmatized as well. Like it's associated with, you know, laziness and
yeah.
And all the. Well, I think that's true all around the world, but like what are some of the, can we talk a little bit about those stigmas and this you know, this kind of propaganda and stigmatization of some extreme cases?
Well, the line we use in the United States was, yeah, people talk about marijuana as being the gateway drug, right? They say, yeah, it's a gateway to the White House, right? Because almost not just Obama, but presumably George Bush as well, and Bill Clinton, had all used marijuana
right.
before. And at one point, most of the candidates, you know, had used marijuana. Not the Republicans necessarily, but although George Bush
yeah.
had.
NBA so, players, fighters.
And the truth is, if I look at some of the philanthropists who were the biggest supporters, you know, many of them had used marijuana beforehand. In the case of Soros, he had smoked marijuana, but he wasn't that interested in it. He just done it when he briefly in his 30s. But a couple of the other major donors, a guy named Peter Lewis and another one, George Zimmer, major, you know, these were guys who smoked marijuana, sometimes daily, and who built multi-billion dollar corporations while using cannabis daily. For some of them, it was quasi-medical in their use.
Right.
So the notion, the number of people, I went to Harvard University, one of the best universities in the world. The number of my, you know, friends who either got high or I used to get high with, and many of us have gone on to have enormously successful lives, including in some types of the professional world where you're not allowed to use drugs, like military or intelligence or things like that.
Right.
So the whole notion of the stigma with cannabis is kind of crazy.
Yeah.
Now, of course, the fact is, even with the other illicit drugs, I mean, none of us would want to have our kid using heroin. But what people generally believe about heroin, the science, the addictiveness, is so far removed from the actual truth or facts about its real danger. How many people know that if you have access to a clean, regulated supply of pharmaceutical heroin, you can take it every day and live to be 95 years old? How many people know that taking heroin in a pure form every day does not destroy your internal bodily organs, right? I mean, you know, you smoke too many cigarettes, gives you lung cancer. You take too much cocaine, you might have a heart attack. You have too much alcohol, you know, you'll get cirrhosis of the liver. You take pharmaceutical pure heroin every day, it's not going to destroy your bodily organs. It's not to recommend doing it.
Right.
It's got a stickiness about it, like nicotine, that can get you dependent upon it, and that's not a good thing in our world. But people don't know some of the most basic facts. Being at this conference, you know, Camille, and hearing about the cases involving the prosecution of people for ayahuasca around the world, and what prosecutors say about ayahuasca or the Santo
right.
Daime ceremonies.
That's awful.
I mean, it's like every sentence out of that prosecutor's mouth is either ill-informed or an outright lie.
Right.
Right? And in that mainstream setting, part of what we, the people involved in this conference here, people in this growing drug policy reform movement around the world, what we're trying to do is not just change the laws, but change the consciousness and understanding. It's understanding that any psychoactive substance can be used either responsibly or irresponsibly.
Right.
There are people who can get terribly addicted to cannabis, and there are people who can use heroin or cocaine responsibly.
Well, the thing is that, yeah, the cases that get mediatized, that we see in the media, are in the conventional stories that are scary and all that, are cases of, you know, people who usually have an underlying issue that they're not dealing with, like psychologically
exactly.
and so on. And then, it's sort of the accelerator is that drug, right, of that issue that's underlying. But we never talk about all the people that are super healthy and stable.
It's also that, yeah. you know, if you look at drug selling happens just as commonly in white suburbs, or I guess in France it's black suburbs, but just in affluent white neighborhoods as it does in poor black or brown neighborhoods. But it tends to be a little more open and on the streets in black and brown poor neighborhoods. And it tends to be maybe behind closed doors and done discreetly, and there's less violence in affluent white neighborhoods.
Right.
You know, the media, the cops focus on the stuff that's easier to find, or they focus on those populations that are already being more heavily surveyed and policed because of all sorts of reasons, ranging from racism to higher crime rates. So the whole thing's built in. I mean, the fact of the matter is, boil it down to this. When you think about all the psychoactive drugs as commodities, you open this show by talking about sugar and salt and things like this, right? They're all commodities. They're all, you know, sugar and salt are psychoactive commodities as well. They are all global commodities for which there is a powerful global demand. So long as there is a powerful demand, there will be a global supply. Ultimately, our choice as societies, communities, governments, or even globally, is how are we going to regulate this global commodities market? Well, with sugar and salt, and with alcohol and tobacco and tea and a range of others, we said we're going to legally regulate it. We're going to have to deal with the overwhelming power of certain corporate players and all this. But with these other substances, some of which are less dangerous than the legal substances, in fact, most of them are less dangerous, you know, we're going to have the cops and the prosecutors and military in charge of regulating what is essentially a global commodities market.
Right.
And that's absurd.
Right. Share Cosmic with your friends and colleagues. We're talking about topics that are extremely important, and I'm bringing you the best guests that I can find on the road. Really fascinating discussions, learning a lot. I'm wondering, like, if there is, if we have a few people listening here that are active in that space or want to get active in that space, maybe in other areas of the world, do you have some sort of a blueprint or a key recommendation that you follow when it comes to how change is going to move in that region? Like maybe talking about the cultural slash narrative dimension, mm-hmm. and then, you know, policy, legal, well, you know, investment.
The old slogan, right, that think global, act local, or all politics is local. So for people who want to get involved, the most important thing is to get involved where you live to the extent possible. And if there's already an organization that exists, think about joining it and participating in it rather than starting your own. One problem you have is people want to start their own thing and then you just get this multiplicity of ineffective right. organizations. There's an organization called IDPC, International Drug Policy Consortium, that basically is a network of advocacy organizations for drug reform all around the world. And that's a good place to start to see what might be active in your country. If it's in the United States, you can contact the organization that I ran, Drug Policy Alliance. It's drugpolicy.org, and see what's going on right there. And really, you know, I mean, the model we pursued oftentimes, for Drug Policy Alliance, we worked on three major areas, as I said. Marijuana reform was one third. Ending mass incarceration, the drug war elements of mass incarceration, was the second third. And the third was harm reduction, advancing a public health human rights approach to drugs. And we would sort of look at, well, if we're working in New Jersey, or if we're working in Louisiana, or if we're working in Ohio, what's going to be, should we start with needle exchange, trying to legalize needle exchange, or should we start with medical marijuana? Or should we start by taking on the issue of mandatory minimum drug sentences? Or we should try to get, so we look for where was the receptivity? Mm-hmm. Where were their local legislators or council people are interested? Where was there a crisis? Is there a crisis recently about overdoses happening in your town? Then focus on addressing that issue. You know, people used to, when we first legalized medical marijuana in California in 96, and Soros had provided about 30% of the funding. And so I went to see him, and he asked me, well, what's our next move, right? And I said, our next move, George, I want you to make a very public $1 million contribution to support needle exchange programs. So we went from medical marijuana to needle exchange. We went from, it's thinking that sometimes the best way to accomplish change is not a straight ahead strategy, it's an indirect strategy.
Oh, wow.
You know, the best way to ultimately reduce the arrests of young men of color for marijuana was to start off with by doing medical marijuana, which was not talking at all about race. It was talking about sick people who needed marijuana as their medicine, and thereby beginning to transform the imagery of marijuana and who the marijuana consumer was, and thereby softening up sentiment on that front that then allowed us to take on the issue around the, you know, the disproportionate number of black people who were being arrested for marijuana. So sometimes one has to think strategically when it comes to language and the language of advocacy. So many activists say, I'll tell you what an advocate is, I just got to tell people what I think and what I believe and use the language that's meaningful to me. And I say to that, bullshit. You use the language that's going to speak to the people you're trying to move. Yep. If you're trying to move your parents, speak the language and use the evidence that they will understand. Don't force them to learn your language at the same time that you wanted them to embrace the message that you're using, right? Mm. And so, you know, if I want to speak to conservatives, I don't use the same liberal speak that I would use with liberals, right? It's about being sensitive to how we frame these things. In a way, you know, the kind of elder sibling of the marijuana reform movement was the gay rights movement. A lot of similarities, both movements about personal freedom and social justice, both about reducing stigmatization and demonization, both about encouraging some level of normalization, all of these sorts of things, and also addressing deep-seated fears on the parts of people and parents and what have you.
Right.
Well, one had to learn how to do this in the right way and use the right imagery, right? And do it in a sophisticated way. So this is going to be so different whether one's talking about Stockholm or Lund, whether one's talking about Copenhagen or Barcelona or New Orleans or you know, Edmonton, you know, Canada or wherever it might be, right? I've recently been in some countries in Africa, in Tanzania and Kenya and South Africa, and some of the arguments and cases, there's a fundamental universality and similarity to many of these issues, but the particulars and the language and all of these things, you have to understand that to be an effective advocate.
Wow. Well, those are great learning lessons. Last question, I'm interested in maybe learning lessons that you have at the personal level, like looking at those few decades of activism and policy work and all that in that space. Is there anything that you learned about yourself?
Well, I'll tell you, when I first was shifting from academia to the activism, I went to visit a famous teacher named Ram Dass. Ram Dass was a leading sort of, he had worked with Timothy Leary under a different name, and then he became a leading sort of spiritual guru teacher. And he said to me two pieces of advice he gave me. He said, first, Ethan, you need to learn to love William Bennett. Now, William Bennett was the right-wing Republican reactionary who was the first U.S. drug czar 30 years ago under the first President Bush.
Wow.
A person I really just see as a force of profound evil.
Yeah.
But here was Ram Dass saying, I have to learn to love him. And what I took that to mean was the only way that we could succeed in our objectives is by being able to speak to and embrace and hold the fear of those people who are most opposed to us. The fear of the parent around their kid getting into drugs. The fear of somebody who had lived with addiction, their family, traumatizing the family. The person who had been, I mean, it was by understanding that level. And the second thing he said to me is, you have to learn to let go of your attachment to the things you're fighting for. And what I took him to mean by that was this struggle to end the war on drugs, which is a struggle basically, you know, for, you know, science, compassion, health, and human rights, win or lose, it's the right fight. Now, I'm a competitive guy and I like to win and I care about winning. But ultimately, even if I had been less successful, even if marijuana had not been the campaign, even the prison populations were not coming down in the U.S. now, all this, it still would have been worth fighting. And then there's the other basic things. I mean, you know, the golden rule. Treat people you want to be treated. Don't treat people the other way you wouldn't want to be treated. Treat all human beings with respect. Listen deeply. I mean, I can talk, as you can hear. I can talk and talk and talk forever. But the ability to really listen deeply and compassionately, both to allies and to the people on the other side, without blinders, without thinking what you're going to say next, is so pivotally important. You know, the old line that you can conquer the world if you let other people take credit, you know, that's another thing as well. You know, ego can get in the way so easily. Ego helps drive us, but it can get in the way if it gets out of hand.
Right.
And quite frankly, I will say that the psychedelics have played an important role in my life. You know, for me, it's been the journey with these substances. At times, it's helped clarify things to me about what my role can be, about what my life is meant to be. So understanding how to have a responsible relationship to psychoactive substances, both the ones that are very risky and also the ones that can offer so much wisdom if you let them, which are the psychedelic substances, I think that's another thing. Not everybody can do it, but I think most people can and probably should and learn how to benefit.
Well, that's a great way to conclude. Great pieces of wisdom right there. I'm taking with me a lot of learning lessons, and well, I will keep diving into this. It's such a complex space where a lot is going on. This was great. I'll hit you up next time I'm in New York and we have a chapter two.
What do you say? I look forward to that. Sounds like fun.
Well, thanks so much for passing by.
Sure.
All right.
My pleasure.
Take care. Ciao.
Thank you.